Hi, everyone. Good evening. I'm WITF's Director of Community Engagement, Heather Woolridge. Thank you so much for joining us for this special screening event and panel discussion celebrating the 50th anniversary of the passage of the state's Environmental Rights Amendment. Today is the actual 50th anniversary of the passage of that amendment. So we're excited to be able to host this virtual event. Is, of course, presented by WITF Public Media in Harrisburg in partnership with StateImpact Pennsylvania and the Pennsylvania Parks and Forest Foundation. We invite you to also participate in this panel discussion. If you have a question or comment, please type it in the chat window, or you can also email us at discuss@witf.org. Right now, please join me in welcoming our moderator for this evening, StateImpact Pennsylvania reporter, Rachel McDevitt. And welcome to our panelists, Cindy Dunn, Secretary of the Pennsylvania Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, State Senator Franklin Curry, Rafika Muhammad. She is with the Harrisburg Environmental Advisory Council, and she is also a member of the Environmental Justice Advisory Board with the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection. Welcome to Emma Olney. She is on the Governor's Youth Council for Hunting, Fishing, and Conservation, and she's also a Wildlife Leadership Academy Conservation Ambassador. And finally, Sophia Portilla. She is a climate justice youth advocate with CASA, which is a working class Latino and immigrant rights organization. Thank you so much to all of you for joining us this evening. And at this point, I'm gonna turn things over to you, Rachel, for our discussion.
Great, thanks so much, Heather. And thank you all for being here. Thank you to our panelists and thank you to our audience for joining us to mark what is a cool anniversary, 50 years of the Environmental Rights Amendment in Pennsylvania. It passed 50 years ago, but as we heard in the documentaries that we just saw some clips of, the amendment didn't really have any teeth until about 7 years ago in 2014 with the Robinson Township case. So Senator Curry, what was that like for you when that finally was recognized with the intention that you had had for it in the 60s and 70s?
It was one of the most stunning moments of my life, legally and politically. My wife and I had just come back from Philadelphia, and we get off the train around 3 o'clock, and we walked in the door, and I got a phone call from John Dernbach, the professor at Winder Law School. He said, "Have you seen the opinion?" I said, "What opinion?" Well, he sent it to me, and it was at 150 pages or so. My wife was a law school graduate also, and I spent the evening reading it. We couldn't believe it. It was absolutely stunning. And after 40 years, the Supreme Court to finally told the other courts of Pennsylvania they had to read the English language. And that to me was the most stunning thing of the whole thing.
And so what were your hopes when that decision was handed down? Did you have any specific hopes for how it would be used?
Well, no, I didn't get any specifics of cases, but I knew if the courts were reading the amendment in light of the English language, which is the way it's supposed to be read, plain English, that they would apply it properly and it would become effective. And that's what's happened. So I felt terrific about that. I've never quite gotten over it.
Secretary Dunn, is there anything that happened at the state level with that decision that you could, they would be able to tell us about? Or is there a way that the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources had to maybe reassess its role in the light of that decision?
Yeah, the actual time, I was not at the Commonwealth. That was a period of time I was working with a group called Penn Future. And I do remember I was in Philadelphia walking and crossing that busy intersection around City Hall, and my iPhone just lit up. And I started reading it, probably endangering myself a little bit there in the traffic. And it was stunning. I mean, just reading the words were stunning. But of course, my heart is always with the natural resources and the public lands and such. And in that case, number one, it underpins the value of the common resources that we all hold, the public natural resources. It recognizes the interconnectedness that, impacts on that environment, whether they be on public lands or on private land, need to be protected, because air and water and land and access to the natural environment isn't confined to any one place. And it gave citizens and people empowered them to really act on behalf of preserving those rights for themselves. So that was what was phenomenal about that case. And then it and as Franklin said, it mentions the plain English language of the constitutional amendment, and the courts in the case law and the practice of government to apply what's called the Payne versus Kassab case, which incidentally in government, even the Payne versus Kassab test, which really brings in the economic side to detriment at times of the environmental side, even with using that, we were losing important cases when I was in government. So to have the plain constitutional language of that amendment upheld was empowering to anybody really in conservation, whether it be in government or in the private sector or citizens who had seen the incremental degradation of the environment in their communities.
Yeah, I want to go to our youth panelists. Emma, we'll start with you. I'm curious if you had heard much about the Environmental Rights Amendment in school or in the work that you had done with conservation and on the governor's youth committee, which I've lost your title here, but is this something that you thought of as a right, or was it, how did you view environmental rights, or did you know of this amendment sort of growing up?
Yeah, so I only really found out about the amendment through the Wildlife Leadership Academy. We have to do outreach every year throughout the summer and the school year after we leave the camp in the summer. And so that includes volunteer work and keeping up with different media outlets, either sharing our story or listening to different documentaries and stuff like that. And so actually I remember seeing those two documentaries that we just watched clips from. And so that's how I learned about the Environmental Rights Amendment actually. And so, I mean, I remember doing like a little report about it for my outreach and things like that, but I didn't really start to apply it, I think, to my own life and really take in that, like use it as a lens until I started my work with the Governor's Youth Council, because we do a lot of work with environmental legislation, particularly with outdoor recreation and the Game Commission and stuff like that. And that's when it sort of became more like individual and personal for me.
Sophia?
Yeah, so I really had no prior knowledge to the amendment. I'm glad that I know about it now, because clearly it pioneered such a movement in Pennsylvania and really like brought up that morale. So kudos to Senator Curry. But I really think it's something that's been overlooked. I know it was mentioned in the documentary how, we all viewed it as something that we could really use as an asset, but of course, in Pennsylvania, where like fracking and the oil and railroad and steel industries are so large and hold so much power in our state, I think it was something that obviously, as citizens, we would like for those rights to be upheld. But I think there was definitely room for some, they didn't really prioritize us citizens is what I'm saying.
Yeah, I understand that. Rafika, I think you would have something to add to that, because I'm wondering if for you and in the work that you do around the city of Harrisburg, if that decision that happened in 2014 had any real impact on people living in the city or people that were seeing an environmental problem in their backyards maybe. Does that ruling have much of an effect for them?
Thank you for that. No, because was not aware of it. Here in the city of Harrisburg and where I sit and tables that I sit at and talk to my community, no one knows anything about it. By me sitting on the Environmental Advisory Council for the city that was created through the debacle we had here with the, what we got over there, the incinerator, and getting resources from that, that's what created our Environmental Council. We're really able to start engaging our community, our residents, to really take a look at our environment in our own backyards. So our capital, which I had said a couple weeks ago on a couple other platforms, our capital is a mess. I mean, I it's just no words for it. So when, you know, I'm learning about the amendment, I heard about the amendment when I first got on the Environmental Justice Advisory Board for the state. So like for me, this is new information, learning about legislative, you know, documents and things of that nature. But when you're talking about grassroots down to the core of people, particularly in housing projects, et cetera, we don't know any of this information. We don't even know where to begin, but we do see what's going on in our communities. We're seeing mudslides and sinkholes and flooding, et cetera. So it's just bringing more communication, more education, and more knowledge to the people that this is really impacting, because we really don't have a clue what's happening on the higher levels.
Right. Yeah, and I think we should point out, you know, it's taken so long for the courts to recognize the Environmental Rights Amendment as having some power, some governing power, as it should, as a constitutional amendment. The Environmental Justice Advisory Board, which you're a member of, is working to try to get more teeth into the environmental justice provisions in the state, because we have environmental justice communities defined, but the protections for them are pretty nebulous. And so there is a process now. I'm not sure if you want to share just a little bit about what you're hoping might happen as a result of that process.
Well, I know there's been some discussion. We just did about a month ago, a statewide symposium dealing with climate change, environmental justice, et cetera. And yes, we need to have more teeth, and we also need to have funding to go with the teeth. A lot of us has been doing a lot of this work with little to no funding and resources. Everybody can't always do volunteer. You know, it's good, but it's not, it can't be sustaining. But a lot of us are doing the grassroots work. We're on the ground doing the work, and we're being impacted the most. So it's a big puzzle that we're still putting together. I'm gonna look at it like that. But people just need to come into some of these communities that we talk about. That's another thing. We just don't engage with each other. I'm gonna continue using that word. People need to come and look at your capital and look beyond those buildings, walk into the communities and see exactly what's going on in your backyard. And just, you know, we need to come together and decide how we're going to fix this, because really on the other side of this, which we're really not talking about, and maybe we should talk about this evening, is our health impact, because all of this is playing a serious health issue on our health impact, whether it's through cancer, or whether it's through asthma. I just found out how so many people die just right here in Dauphin County dealing with our air quality. I mean, we're breathing toxic air every day because we have an incinerator that's only a few miles from my house that emits stuff in the air. We breathe that. I live right across the street from an industrial plant on 7th Street. The dust that comes from that, I'm constantly washing my doors and windows. So we need to have some, again, engagement, grassroots, people that's working on Capitol Hill really need to come down to our level, and let's have these engagements and conversations and how we can deal with this together.
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought up, sorry, Secretary Dunn, did you have something to add?
Oh, no, I was just listening. Okay.
Sorry, but I want to pivot. I'm glad, Rafika, you brought up climate change, because we saw in the documentaries, you know, at the time that Senator Curry, you know, then Representative Curry, introduced the language that would become the Environmental Rights Amendment, you know, he had that visual of those jars of water, the clean water and the polluted water, and it was a very visual and striking thing. With climate change, you know, while natural disasters are very striking when they happen, it seems like it's not as visual right now. So what, how do you think perceptions of environmental rights have changed? And I want to start with Senator Curry.
Well, as you point out, when we were passing Article 1, Section 27, nobody heard of climate change. It was not an issue in discussion. What motivated us was the damage done to our environment by the brazen exploitation of the coal companies, the steel companies, and the railroad companies. So now, 50 years later, climate change is the overriding issue. And the good thing about the amendment is it's broad enough in language that it's a basis for stopping climate change, because it says the government has an obligation to preserve and conserve the environment and a healthy environment. The people have a right to a healthy environment. So if the government can't give us a healthy environment, That's a serious matter, but it should be a responsibility of the government. So that's what the amendment does. Now, it may take litigation and time to make that work, but that's what the goal is, and that's why it's there.
Sophia, I want to turn to you. What, when you think of environmental rights, I mean, what is your perception of where you might be able to see it or where it could be manifested?
Yeah, so I think that it's pretty obvious when you go to these fence line communities who are primarily low income, it's so obvious. It's right in front of them. They're living this reality. So I feel like environmental justice has kind of been a classist issue. Obviously, the talk, I think, kind of can get directed towards saving the polar bears or like saving the turtles or something. But like, there's people who are living this reality. This is them. I mean, 4 out of every 10 colored children have childhood asthma, whereas 1 out of every 10 white child has childhood asthma. You know what I mean? Like, we are living this reality. It's something that, you know, luckily I grew up within a 5-mile radius of 4 different parks, but I mean, compared to a child in West Philadelphia, you know, that's not the case. So I think when it comes to how you visualize it, it really depends on your demographic. And unfortunately, we're seeing these low-income communities of color who are really living through the worst of this like national emergency. And I think some people obviously don't have to live that reality. There's just a really large disparity in who it affects and how urgent of an issue it is that needs to be addressed, especially on a state and federal level.
So I want to follow that up. It sounds like, and I agree with you, I mean, when we look to environmental hazards, I think we should look at people. You know, I think the discussion used to be about the stream or the forest, but now when we want to look at the impacts on our environment, we should look at the people around us. We should look at people in communities who could be feeling the brunt of that pollution burden from industrial facilities and power plants and things like that.
I like that onto that. I mean, I think that's entirely correct. I mean, the case law and the constitutional amendment really places government in a trustee role, and it places. I mean, so when you think about what does that mean, it means understanding the science, and that includes science around health, like Sophia mentioned, includes science around climate. Everyone counts on government to really lean into science and predict and manage catastrophic events that are coming. So there's a big obligation on climate, which we're in Pennsylvania trying to meet. Rafika and I were on a panel recently relating to the climate report and what we're expecting in Pennsylvania, which is pretty dramatic. So when I say government's response as trustee of the natural resources and leaning on the science is more than just the agencies charged with, you know, DCNR actually refers to the Environmental Rights Amendment in our mission statement in Act 18 that created us. But beyond that, it's really an obligation to all of government, the legislature, to all the agencies to serve as that trustee. And not only the people you're seeing today, but generations yet to come. So when you look at the projections from climate change and you think of, you know, say, you know, Sophia and Emma's children and their children's children and their children's children's children. When you play it out that far and you look at the climate projections, then, you know, that adds a significant urgency to the environmental and conservation work, the protection of the natural resources, the understanding of the health issues and concerns, the really engagement of the full community, because it's not only is government, the broad, big government, broad government, all of government charged with the protection, but it's charged with really understanding the science and working proactively for, you know, to work, on behalf of future generations as a trustee. And of course, to do that, the solutions come, and again, that same panel Rafika and I were on, the solutions also come from the community, and it's the solutions involve engaging everybody, both the problems and the solutions involve everyone, you know, science, industry, business sector, all levels of government coming to a common understanding around the science and working together to uphold the obligation that we all have to future generations.
Let me add something about public officials. In Pennsylvania, no matter what office you're elected to, whether it's the legislature or governor or county commissioner, you cannot take office until you take the oath of office, which is to uphold the Constitution of Pennsylvania. That means you're taking an oath to uphold Article 1, Section 27. Now, a lot of people in government don't recognize that, but every citizen, every person who's here today and listening, our panelists, all of us, you're perfectly within your rights to stop a public official or a candidate for a public official and ask them how they view their responsibilities under Article 1, Section 27 as trustees. And put them on the spot. They're running for office. They should be able to answer that question. And you can ask it. You should ask.
Yeah, and I can also add on to that quickly. I mean, I think that like one thing that makes Pennsylvania nationally very unique is the Environmental Rights Amendment. Since it is a state policy, the state constitution, I think one way we can look toward the future is bringing such an amendment to more state constitutions, especially as federal politics get more and more divided. I think we can't really rely as much on the national, federal level government when it's under the influence of, you know, whatever GOP it happens to be. I think at a certain point, states need to take responsibility to, have continuity with conservation of our natural resources. And I think especially having the state government as a trustee of natural resources can really help as we look forward for climate change and for our youth, for sure.
That makes sense.
Thank you. We're going to go to a audience question. Nora asks, how can we hold major polluters of the water and air accountable in our poorer communities? These polluters are often large employers of citizens in our community. And Sophia, I think you have an interest in addressing that one. We'll start with you.
I do. So I know on a state level, there's currently a push for the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, better known as REGGI. And basically what that does is it creates like a standard for how much carbon emissions companies can emit into the air. And basically once they go over that, like, maximum, they begin to get fined, and these fines can generate up to $2.5 billion in funding that can be allocated towards workforce development for these companies, which can then transition these communities who are pretty dependent on these large fossil fuel industries to, promote clean energy, green energy, and sort of get them the proper training they need to make that transition without, not being able to sustain their families or not being able to go back to school and possibly get an education, some form of education to, switch to that sort of industry. So I think on a state legislative level, the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative is something that could potentially be really monumental in not only holding these companies accountable, but also generating the funds we need to get the proper workforce development funding to transition low-income communities to a more sustainable form of energy.
I'll just note that is going through the regulatory process, and Pennsylvania is slated to join next year, early in the year, if the regulation goes through, and we'll see what the legislature does if they decide to direct those funds into more workforce development training and things like that, into environmental justice and economic justice communities as well. But does somebody else want to answer that question?
I do. I love how Sophia explained all of that. I'm trying to get some notes, because when we talk about REGGI, I'm like, okay, like, I don't know. You explained that so excellently well. I really appreciate that. Thank you. I know that some of us on the Environmental Justice Advisory Board will be talking to and I'm bad with names. And we will be talking to, I think, a senator tomorrow, just about what she was just explaining about Wrigley and Igley and all those things that's getting ready to happen here, and how we're going to use those dollars once they start coming into Pennsylvania. So yeah, we're really trying to get some teeth into environmental justice and really, you know, utilizing those funds and resources, like I mentioned earlier, to really help these Black and Brown communities really come out of this environmental mess. We are living in a cesspool. That's the only way I can call it. You see holes in the street, you don't know if that's going to be a mudslide or if it's going to be a sinkhole. Again, you're seeing all kinds of particulates in the air that's falling all over you. You don't know where it's coming from. So we have a lot of work to do in our own capital, and I'm very excited to be a part of this. This is history. All what we're talking about, yes, it's 50 years of what Senator Curry is doing, but now we're creating history again to look at 50 years down the line. So I'm very excited to be a part of it.
Yeah, absolutely. I want to take just a minute to sort of acknowledge our partner in this event, the Pennsylvania Parks and Forests Foundation, and look at that more, I hate to use the word traditional idea of environmental rights or of conservation, but we do look to our parks and forests as places of refuge and of places where we do have that pristine nature that all Pennsylvanians should be able to enjoy. So Emma and Secretary Dunn, I want to direct this question to you. What threats do you see to our green spaces, our natural spaces around the state, and what can we do to protect them and make them accessible to all Pennsylvanians? And I'll start with Secretary Dunn.
Sure, no, I appreciate that. And yeah, as I mentioned on the one clip, there's nothing more democratizing than public spaces. You know, that's what makes us as Pennsylvanians wealthy. We all own 121 state parks. We own 2.2 million acres of Pennsylvania that we serve as trustee for. And many local parks and many local assets are held by municipal governments and such. And the threats to them are perhaps more subtle in some ways than they were at the time when Franklin Curry held up the dirty water and the clean water issues, like climate change and atmospheric changes and rising temperatures cause all kinds of impacts on the natural environment. We're seeing scientifically complex, however, really dramatic changes, like a pollinator emerges at a different time than the tree it pollinates blossoms due to climate change. Tree blossoms too early because of climate change. The pollinator comes later. The reproduction doesn't happen. Shifts in species, increase in invasive species, increase in water temperature directly relates to sports issues like the brook trout. You know, Pennsylvania's fish is really threatened by warm water from a change in climate. Pennsylvania's state tree, the hemlock, is threatened by hemlock woolly adelgid, which has increased, like a lot of invasive species, increased during climate change. Pennsylvania has recently named amphibian, the mud puppy is now threatened, due to the changing conditions in our water. So it's just myriad changes by climate change, and also the continued sprawl development and impacts in developed spaces across public lands and on private lands. We changed the footprint of Pennsylvania, which, Pennsylvania stands for Penn's Woods. Our natural environment is forest. And so the extent we can retain that natural character everywhere is going to be better for our environment and support us with the clean water and clean air that we need in our day-to-day lives.
Before Emma chimes in, I just want to add to potential threats to the forest. There is an effort from some lawmakers who want to expand drilling operations in state forests, that there's a pressure to make you pay for yourself in the state budget and things like that. What's sort of your response to that push to let industry further into the state parks?
Right, as you know, like Governor Wolf instituted, and really at the encouragement and support of DCNR, a moratorium on additional leases and drilling in the state in the public lands, and we felt that the drilling that had been allowed in the past, it was left to continue because of the legally binding contracts, but and we think it's enough. You know, we don't think that the public forest lands, especially in the parks, are the right place for industrial development of any kind. They are there for other purposes, for recreation, for renewing the environment, for the clean water that flows from these forests, the clean air that helps purify the air, even across our cities. So we think that, industrial development in the state forest land is not appropriate. So we continue to try to point to the other values that bring citizens, economic value too, by the way. And Pennsylvania is big on a tourist economy, big on economic value from the clean air and clean water from these lands. They serve their purpose, and they really support the investment made by the public in the public lands. The public gets back in droves what they put into them. So it's certainly worth that investment. And it's there again for future generations to preserve for future generations. You can't allow this incremental harm that would come from additional drilling.
Emma, what's your take?
Yeah, one thing that I've really noticed a lot working with the Governor's Youth Council for Hunting, Fishing, and Conservation, something we've been focusing on a lot in our legislative work is wildlife diseases, like chronic wasting disease in our state mammal white-tailed deer or West Nile virus in our state bird ruffed grouse. We've done a lot of work trying to, working with the Pennsylvania Game Commission and learning more about their disease management areas for chronic wasting disease and really how we can control the spread of such a threat to one of our most prolific animals in the state. And I think one way that the youth perspective has been really helpful in that is it seems that especially in legislation, the youth perspective is really, favored very highly and taken into consideration, because again, we are that generation that's coming, that's rising, and we will support the future generations. And so I think that's a really important perspective to take. And I think especially in outdoor recreation, like hunting, that can be used in conservation efforts and like wildlife management, especially as climate change mounts. I think it's more important than ever to get youth involved in activities such as hunting, because that population is declining of, young hunters. And so bringing them in for the purpose of scientific wildlife management and recreation is very important as we look forward. So that's what I've encountered.
Yeah. How do you think we encourage people to take an interest? As you just mentioned, the hunter population is sort of declining in Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, obviously word of mouth from, peer to peer is great, but I think at this point, change needs to come from a legislative level. I know, for example, at the Pennsylvania Game Commission, the Governor's Youth Council in 2019 worked for Senate Bill 147 to legalize Sunday hunting in Pennsylvania. And one of our main, pushes for that was to increase the number of days that Pennsylvanians can hunt, and that would really accommodate working Pennsylvanians and, students who are in school. So high school and college age students can get more involved in hunting on the weekends. So I think things like that, expanding hunting seasons, we're hoping to expand it to more Sundays than three out of the year, hopefully all Sundays within the seasons. But I think that's something that could really be done. And also even just students attending testimonies, like public testimonies at the state agencies and voicing their opinions, or even just going to listen to see what issues are going on. A lot of them are virtual these days, so it's even easier just to call in.
Yeah.
That would be my recommendations.
Easier and easier to participate. Mm-hmm. Want to get to just a couple more questions before we reach the end of our time. We had some question. A viewer asked, what is the status of the challenge that remains pending in Robinson Township? I wanted to put that out there in case anybody knew. Are there challenges to these cases that would have promoted more environmental rights or held up the amendment that are facing legal challenges that people should be concerned about or could do something about?
Well, I don't know of any challenge to the Robinson Township case. That case was only decided by a plurality of judges. It wasn't a majority. But a couple of years later, in the PEDF case brought by John Child for the Pennsylvania Environmental Defense Fund, the court did give a majority opinion to what Castile had done in the Robinson Township case. And it said that the Payne versus Kassab test was no longer valid. It was dispatched to the 8th Canada judicial history. So I think the amendment is pretty solidly in set. Now the question is how it is applied. And let me just add one other point, that the amendment was broadly drafted. It's like the First Amendment, Second and Third Amendments are all broadly drafted. We didn't want to get too specific because that would limit its use. But as broadly stated, it can grow and people can, lawyers and their citizens can seek to apply it to solve the problems.
And I think that gets to sort of a summary question that we can maybe end on with some final thoughts. We've had a couple questions about what people can do to help. What are ways that you suggest for individuals in a community to begin a movement to advocate for their environmental rights? I want to point out that Senator Curry has mentioned that the amendment and having it recognized by the courts gives people a tool to take their cases to court, to take a lawsuit. But I'm curious also about other things that we can do at a smaller, a state, a community level to raise everybody's environmental standards. So we can maybe start with Sophia.
Yeah, absolutely. So I would just like to say that I'm very grateful to be a member of CASA. They've given me the opportunity to, you know, do numerous amounts of work with senators, legislators, news outlets, in terms of really promoting the issues that are most pressing to minority communities. I don't want anyone to feel like it's exclusive at all. We fight for basically all human rights. So I think really going out there and getting involved in, like Rafika said, grassroots organizations. I know the Sierra Club also pushes a lot of environmental justice legislation and awareness for citizens, especially disenfranchised communities. I think right now would be just kind of cool to mention that Emma and I actually go to the same high school and we have a community conservation club. Emma started it and we actually implemented composting in the school cafeteria. So a little plug to Emma there. She's really awesome for that. But I think community engagement is also a large factor of this, you know, having people feel helpless, like there really isn't anything they can do, is something that I feel discourages people from actually doing just small acts like a community garden or, you know, even with more green spaces within cities. Like I know York City, I think it would be great if we had a bit more of community involvement in terms of like environmental awareness, not just parks with like basketball courts, things like that. So I think there's actually a lot you can do on a community level. You really just have to get out there and get involved. And hopefully with this issue becoming more and more pressing, we'll see a rise in people, you know, getting out there and really using their voices and being heard.
Emma?
I mean, I think going along with what Sophia says, I think one thing that could be impactful is having people in power like politicians and legislators working from the top down with policies, but you know, the average citizen working from the bottom up, I think is really important. Like starting with your local ecosystem, which includes the human beings in your community around yourself, as well as the wildlife and the plants and the streams and everything, I think can be really impactful. Like Sophia mentioned, you know, even something as simple as starting a project like to bring in that service component can be really impactful in your local ecosystem. And I think we would also do well by putting pressure on people working from the top down, whether that's just writing a letter, which I've done, and I've almost never not gotten a response back from a legislator, because I think they really do value youth perspective. And I think that's something that is pretty easy to do and can have a really great impact. And also I think focusing on your state culture, which here, you know, focuses a lot on hunting and fishing, bringing that into conservation and scientific conversations is important as well.
Rafika?
Oh, there's a couple of things I can mention about this here. I know one thing that we're going to do definitely here in the city of Harrisburg through our Environmental Advisory Council is we're calling it a Clean Sweep Harrisburg. We are giving a lot of our residents the tools that they need to keep their outdoor spaces clean. People throw their trash, and I don't know where they think the trash is going to go. I just don't know. It's everywhere, and that's a change of behavior. So what we're going to do is we're in our local communities are in the hood, and we're going to hand out brooms and gloves and dustpans and teach people, educate people the importance of keeping their own environment clean. We are the environment ourselves, so we have to start with ourselves. So if they're sweeping off their porches property, bagging their trash property, breaking down, we have a serious recycling component here, learning how to do that properly. I'm going to be teaching some classes soon about how to grow food in containers and using worms for composting, et cetera. People just need to be educated. We are very disconnected. And then when we talk about different people, cultures, particularly Black people, when we talk about Latino people, some of these people come with that already with them. As far as Black people, we have been disengaged a lot with the environment. When I talk about that, people look at me very strange, especially when we talk about growing food and anything dealing with agriculture. People forget that we came here to do just that. So for me, I have to do a whole educational piece about why it's okay to put our hands back on the land, why it's okay that we can grow food and do things that we couldn't do. So that's the whole historical and cultural context. When we talk about getting and engaging with our community, we have a lot of these organizations that's in our backyard that do not engage in communities of color, Black, brown, et cetera. So we have a lot of work to do. We also have to deal with systematic racism through this whole piece. We could talk about the environment all day long and all these nooks and crannies, but if we don't really get to know each other, none of this work is going to matter at all. So that's, I'm not saying that to be negative to no one. That's a fact. So a lot of the agencies, like I said, their offices are here, but we don't see them really engaging in these communities. So that's one way we can do. Let's sit down and have a conversation on how we all can work together and how we can make a change and a difference. So that's what I'm pushing for. And continuing on educating our people and letting them know it's okay to get dirty. It's okay. Yeah. It's okay to clean your community. It's okay. It's okay if you don't know. Ask somebody so we can help you. It's okay. So it's those little things and those little small things will make a difference. And that's what we've been doing and really starting to engage people. And they're like, I really didn't understand that, Rafika. I really didn't know that. And I just tell them, it's okay. We're going to learn together.
Secretary Dunn.
No, I really like all those words. I mean, I think we all have to reach in and find each other. We're breathing the same air. We're sharing the same water. No major environmental movement has ever succeeded without engaging all people. It's just interesting recently in Chesapeake Bay work. I'm proud to say, Pennsylvania was really in the lead of that, really engaging with the full community. I mean, it takes the full community to engage, but both because electing officials who care, reaching out like Rafika's doing tomorrow, reaching out and saying you care, the letters that Emma referred to, the context Sophia referred to. I think there's this misimpression that there has to be 100 letters before a legislator or a government official pays attention. That's just simply not true. A few voices make a difference and are wise. So I think working together, reaching together, government's got to find ways to better serve all citizens, including generations yet to come, and what we're doing in state government now under the guidance of the governor, system-wide agency, all the agencies really looking to how our mission is serving all Pennsylvanians. And in DCNR, that work is really it's really fun, frankly. I mean, we have a great mission, and nothing better than bringing it to all people, but it requires a deeper engagement and understanding of needs. So we have a goal to put a park and a trail within 10 minutes of every Pennsylvanian. So no matter what your zip code, you should have access to those assets and have a shared shared access to the environment, to the natural resources. So this is work that we often do. I think Rafika is right. Both all sides have to look around and reach out and communicate and frankly demand the best from each other.
Yeah. And Senator Curry, final word, what should people be doing? What can they do to strengthen environmental rights in Pennsylvania?
Well, the most important thing is that we look forward to the next 50 years. We don't just celebrate, we move forward. And the thing to remember is it's the idea that counts, and the idea we all have a right to a healthy environment, and the government is responsible for saying that we get it. Those are simple, fundamental ideas. And the strength to make those happen is at the local level. What Rafika and others are saying here, it's as good as the people who go to their legislators or town officials and say, look, we've got a problem. We think you as a trustee under Article 1, Section 27, have a responsibility to help do something about it. What are you going to do? So as long as people believe it and they advocate it to their town council, to the city, the mayors, the legislators, and so on, at the grassroots level, that's where the strength is. The Constitution is more than a sheet of paper with words on it. It's only as good as the people who believe it and advocate it. So I think the people here in this program tonight have really done a good job of that. And I say amen to all of them. So let's go forward to the next 50 years believing in this simple process, simple principles, and advocating that they be properly enforced.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Thank you to all of our panelists. And I'm going to turn it over to Heather to close us out.
Thank you, Rachel. Once again, thank you to State Impact Pennsylvania reporter Rachel McDevitt and to our panelists, Cindy Dunn, Secretary of the Pennsylvania Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, State Senator Franklin Curry, Rafika Muhammad, Emma Olley, and Sophia Portilla. Thank you, everyone, for joining us tonight and sharing your different perspectives and views. A very insightful conversation. Thank you, too, to our audience for the great questions and comments. Really appreciate it. Want to acknowledge State Impact Pennsylvania and the PA Parks and Forest Foundation for helping to make tonight's event possible. This evening, the video clips that we saw earlier were just clips from larger, fuller documentaries. If you're interested in checking those out, you can visit video.witf.org to see the full pieces. You can also learn more about Pennsylvania's rich conservation history and heritage at pennsylvaniaconservationheritage.org. Real quickly, I want to just plug two other upcoming events that you might also be interested in connected to this topic. The Ned Smith Center for Nature and Art, located near Millersburg, is also hosting a gallery exhibit to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Pennsylvania Environmental Rights Amendment. And that exhibit is open now through mid-August. The exhibit is called The Green Amendment, Celebrating Half a Century of Environmental Rights. It shares examples of the work being done to conserve and enhance the public resources across the state right now. You can visit the nedsmithcenter.org for more information. And also, this coming Monday, May 24th at 6 p.m., WITF and State Impact Pennsylvania, in partnership with Midtown Scholar Bookstore, is pleased to welcome Pulitzer Prize-winning author Elizabeth Colbert as she shares and presents about her new book, Under a White Sky, The Nature of the Future. During this virtual event, Colbert will be in conversation with State Impact PA's Rachel McDevitt. Registration is free and open to the public. You can find more information at midtownscholar.com. So once again, thank you to everyone who joined us tonight. Stay safe and healthy. Goodbye and have a wonderful evening.
Thank you, Heather.
Bye. Bye-bye. Thank you.